morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Wild horses. Those two words can conjure up some dramatic images, and here in the 21st century, they still run free in much of the West. In the spectacular Niemeyer Valley of BC's Chilcotin country, an elusive herd of wild horses known as the Cayuse, spelt Q-A-Y-U-S, have thrived for centuries, but climate change, the threat of overpopulation, and an increase in natural predators are pitting horse against horse, and it's become kind of a fight for survival. The Zenigwetin First Nation helps restore and manage the population to sustainable levels, and how they do that is capturing, training, and relocating some of them. And the top hands who ride like the wind and have the job of gathering these Mustangs might include some folks you've heard on this program before. And now, television's History Channel is running a series called The Wild Ones, where they actually chronicle the process of gathering and training a number of these unique wild horses. And this week, I'll visit with Barry Davis, the executive producer of the series.
When we put television cameras in that, all of a sudden we're in the way. We could scare the wild horses to do something that they wouldn't normally do.
And this week, Baxter Black has some great ideas about what to do with your time if you run out of things to do.
If you're lucky enough to have an old truck, lots of time can be piddled away keeping it running.
Tell me about it, Bax. And on the Rangeland News, some interesting trends seem to be unfolding.
There could be several factors here. Cow-calf operators have been seeing relatively poor returns.
On the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, I'll look at what the term natural horsemanship means. And the music this week honors those magnificent creatures, the wild horses of the West. And I'll talk with Barry Davis about the Wild Ones TV series after the High Country Cowboys set the stage.
The sun sets on the horizon as he comes into sight. The fading light, he's tall and he's slender and fast as the wind. As he goes running across the canyon's rim, wild Mustang stallion, so wild and so free, the king of the Mustang. Him, some for fun and some for fame, but this wild Mustang stallion won't be caught and won't be tamed. He'll hide out in the canyons by day and then at night. You'll see him silhouetted on a ridge in the pale. King of the Mustangs, you were
Davis is the executive producer of the series titled Wild Horses, now running on TV's History Channel, and the real stars are the Cayuse, a herd of horses that's been running free in the Nehemiah Valley for more than 300 years. And I guess, Barry, there has been a lot of interest in where these unique horses originate and maybe how they got there.
That's correct. I think there's been a lot of studies on the horses in that area, and, you know, depending on which study you're reading, they can trace their lineage back to the land bridge, or at least as far back as as fur traders and early explorers. And some people think that horses were traded with First Nations people who lived there before the first contact. And so however those horses got there, they've been somehow able to survive in an environment that says all of the odds say you shouldn't be able to survive there. The scarce food, the amount of predators, the terrain is very difficult for them to navigate, the altitude, the temperatures. It's quite amazing that they're able to survive there, and somehow they do it. And then I guess as any wildlife population, sometimes they become the victim of their own success. And when they get too good at surviving out there, then there becomes the problem of too many of them, and then the prospects for the ones who aren't at the top of the food chain and the alpha ones are in for a world of hurt when the climate turns and the food isn't as plentiful as it once was, and then things get really dicey for them.
Right. So there's kind of a process of natural selection going on to a certain extent, but the plan is then, I guess, to capture a certain number of them and try to get them schooled as useful working horses.
That's the goal. And I think that, like, before 1970, there was no road into Nehemiah. But once the road came in and a few decades later, obviously the draw of horses into the local economy and local community is far diminished. Trying to find a place and a use for those horses when families in the valley don't need them as much as they did in the past.
We'll look closer at the challenge of getting this project accurately recorded and some of the top hands in the Roundup crew when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. How about a weekend pass to the 24th annual Kamloops Cowboy Festival, March 19th to 22nd, 2020? Another outstanding lineup of the finest pure Western entertainers anywhere. Canadian legend Gary Velger.
Searching for freedom, westward the wagons, they settled in the valleys of sagebrush and pine.
Tom Cole.
In a big prairie moon. Rides the big prairie sky.
The first Kamloops appearance for Doug Figgs.
A good horse under me, it's easy to see. I'm right here where I want to be.
A pasture full of great cowboy poets, the BC Cowboy Hall of Fame inductions, dinner shows, daytime entertainment, and a spectacular art and gear show workshop. The best place to get all the information, bcchs.com. To order tickets, call 1-888-763-2221. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The Wild Ones television series, now running on TV's History Channel, shows the wild horses of the Nehemiah Valley in BC's Chilcotin being rounded up by riders of the Zenegwetan First Nation. And series executive producer Barry Davis is on the line. Now, Barry, what were some of the things in the whole endeavor that really stood out for you?
The one thing as a non-horse person that I can say which kind of blew me away was, you know, if I always tell people, like, you'd watch equestrian events on television and you'd see a horse that takes, you know, has a rider on it and takes a few steps and leaps over a 6 or 8 foot barrier. When we were out there with the chasers in Nehemiah, like, you could see wild horses who see an 8 foot fence and they're standing right beside it and they just go up and over it.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, and as Amanda Lulua, one of the chasers in the show said, you know, they just aren't your backyard ponies. Like they're just on another level. The athleticism and the smarts are what kind of sets those horses apart. And I guess what makes them kind of valuable if you can kind of transform them into something. But it really isn't a fair fight between, I would say, the guys on horseback chasing these guys, because you're really, the odds are not in your favor that you're going to get these guys in. They're just that good at getting away and staying alive. They've avoided grizzly bears and cougars, and sometimes another rider on horseback is no match for them.
Yeah, this is quite a challenge. I have talked to quite a few friends that have done quite a bit of that, capturing wild horses, and you would think that a well-conditioned, grain-fed saddle horse would easily be able to outlast a horse that lives on nothing but native grass and water, but most of them have said it's amazing the stamina that they have, and their grain-fed, well-conditioned saddle horses packing a rider and saddle will play out long before these wild horses will.
Exactly, and that's without giving the series away too much, because it's still exciting to watch. But when people think of this initiative and they think, oh, it's an industry and it's a lucrative thing, and you know they're mining the wild horses, that's a very far-fetched idea. you could even make a sort of enterprise out of this where you're scooping horses in. When you reference the BLM. They, you know, in America, they would get a helicopter and they would chase them around with helicopters and then, you know, tranquilize them or put nets out. And their mission is to get them off the grazing land and put them in the pen so that they're not a nuisance to ranchers. Mm-hmm. This is a very different situation. And, you know, the methods they're using to try to bring the horses in are like you describe. It's this team of 6 to 8 riders trying to corral horses into an area where they go. The chances of success are not high, and the odds are not in your favor. And you could up your odds by using a lot of modern technology and helicopters and those kind of things like they do in the U.S., but it's not something that they're ever going to entertain in this initiative.
Well, I want to talk about some of the members of the cast, including a well-known rancher who's been on this program a few times in the past, and we'll do that right after another song that honors these free spirits. This time from Fred Doberstein.
West of the Rough Creek Timberland, on a wildland grazing lease, we left our bears to raise their foals where the wind blows through the trees. When we returned, the bears were gone where we do not know. They were running with the wild ones along the eastern slopes. We rode the hidden canyon on the mountainside so high, across the blowdowns where the pine trees touch the sky, through the muskegs and the swamp spruce, the tracks were plain to see. Dark shadows in the timber, running wild and free. Wild horses, shadows in the timber, all the rough, hiding on the rugged slope. That wild Mustang band, born to live a free life in that Rocky Mountain land. Wild horses, shadows in the timber on the run, hiding on the rugged slopes of the North Saskatchewan. Out there on the river breaks of the North Saskatchewan. Smoke from an old campfire brings back old memories, the time that we spent riding hard when the wind blows through the trees. We couldn't find the horses, the game we could not win. Out there on the rugged banks of the North Saskatchewan. Wild horses, shadows in the timber on the run, found their tracks along the banks of the North Saskatchewan. A stallion is the leader of that wild Mustang band, born to live a free life in that Rocky Mountain land. wild horses, shadows in the timber on the run, hiding on the rugged slopes of the North Saskatchewan. Out there on the river breaks of the North Saskatchewan.
A great song from Fred Doberstein, and of course the breaks of the North Saskatchewan River are quite a ways from the Nehemiah Valley, but that's where the Wild Ones episodes have been filmed, and executive producer Barry Davis is on the line today.
You've got a colorful cast, a really colorful team there.
Yeah, I think Roy Mulvihill is probably the most important asset that we have out there. He's sort of got a foot in the outside world, and certainly, you know, the Huntingwateen with Chief Jimmy Lilua's family goes way back with Roy's family, and Roy knows the landscape, knows the behavior of the wildies, knows how to transform them. It's sort of a very top-down thing with him, and then we've got a mix of people who've come from away and spent time in the valley and sort of fell in love with it and know it like the back of their hand, and then of course, you know, Chief Jimmy Lilua, Howard Lilua, those guys, their first memory is their dad telling them, get on horseback, we're going to get horses.
Right.
I can't imagine being 5 years old and being involved in chases, but those guys did it.
Yeah, and Amanda is just so charming on camera.
Amazing story with her, too, is that she didn't grow up in a horse family at all. And she was 8 years old, saw horses over the fence, and pleaded with her parents to get her involved with horses. And so her dad has come out to Nehemiah a couple of times and watched her. He came to Williams Lake, watched her in races. Wow, it says that if your kid ever shows an interest in something, do whatever you can to feed that interest, because you don't know where that's going to take them. And it's quite amazing how her parents said, sure, we'll get you. We don't know anything about horses, but we'll get you involved. And boy, it's been her life.
Roy Mulvihill has been, I've had him as a guest on the show a few times and known him for years and years. And we have what we call the British Columbia Cowboy Hall of Fame. And boy, someday I'd like to see someone nominate him for that, because I think he belongs in there.
Oh, there's nothing that Roy can't do or doesn't know. And then for us, I think what is very hard for a lot of people who haven't done this to understand is how taxing it is physically for the riders, how dangerous it is, not just for the wildies who ultimately they want to make sure the wildies are protected and they are safe and that no one gets hurt, including themselves and especially the wildies when they're chasing. And when we put television cameras in that, all of a sudden we're in the way. We could scare the wild horses to do something that they wouldn't normally do. We could ultimately cause an injury to them and potentially the riders. So Roy, along with Howard and Amanda, were really great at understanding what we needed to do from a film and television perspective to capture this endeavor without putting ourselves in a place where we're going to get hurt, and without getting them hurt, and without hurting the wildies. And that was really, I think, you know, like you said, if there's a Cowboy Hall of Fame, there probably isn't a category for that, but Roy is one of those guys who says, I know what you're trying to do, I can see what you have to accomplish here, but if you stand there, the horses could get away, or they could run into a fence, you need to be over here. And, you know, really great, he understood what we needed to do, but he understood how to change the process so everybody gets what they want and the horses live another day.
Well, Barry, I'd like to hear about some of the unforeseen things that happened after the cameras started rolling, and we'll get to that in a little while. Next, though, Baxter Black has some good ideas just in case you run out of things to do. There's another fine song about rounding up the wild ones, this time from Tom Cole, and some big news about our Western Spirit Band and a show that we have coming up when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Howdy, friends. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, and I'll be right back after this with a little peek at being down to no keys.
Your land is a legacy. a challenge from those who tended it before you to build on their foundations. At Corteva Agriscience, we understand what it means to be the stewards of a legacy. We embrace the challenge of building on the foundation of Dow AgroSciences to maintain your trust, to bring new solutions, to help you care for your land. See how we can help build your legacy at rangeandpasture.com.
And for our Canadian listeners, just check Corteva.ca, the Canadian website.
I was visiting with an old capacho the other day. We were talking about being down to no keys. I said, "Partner, have you ever been down and out?" "Down," he said. "I've been down so low I could count the spots on a lizard's belly." Well, I said, "How'd you get by?" "Oh," he said, "when you got a lot of time to kill but no money to spend. Well, let's say I developed some mighty cheap hobbies." "Like what?" says I. "Picking your nose. When you have the time to spend, that can be a highly developed art form. In fact, it should be an Olympic event. And finding addresses of old friends who owe you money. Picking up roadkill. You can render possum grease and sell coon hides. And you can spend a lot of time running your quail traps. And I know 15 different ways to line up cottontails so you can get two with one shot. You know, I taught a wild turkey to fetch and a raven how to bark like a coyote. I know how to season navy beans with prickly pear, and I got 50 recipes for sardines and vienna sausage. I've spliced a million reins, hog-ringed my bit chains, covered my horn with a nut sack just to get by, and a feller can spend a satisfying afternoon hunting old horseshoes. Or you can resole your boots with cowhide, cardboard, sidewalls, or electrical tape, and many's the time I've straightened last year's straw hat. Some other cheap hobbies I've taken up are whittling, straightening nails, culling socks, patching jeans, and remembering. Remembering, you do a lot of that. Summer evenings is a good time to identify insects, and if you're lucky enough to have an old truck, lots of time can be piddled away keeping it running. I've spent plenty of time figuring out which tire to use for a spare, and a field trip to the wrecking yard can be fun and productive. Or jacking it up, collecting the old motor oil and letting it settle so you can use it again. Have you ever used tinfoil for a head gasket? Well, I learned to cut my own hair, drink the less expensive wines, and make a bag of Red Man last 6 weeks. "Gosh," I said, "you ought to write a book." "Oh, I can't," he said. "I'm too busy. This afternoon I'm going through my old razor blades." Yep, it's what the psychologists call quality time. Gosh. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, brought to you by Corteva Agriscience.
Mark your calendar for Ulrich Herford's 14th annual bull sale, Tuesday, February 25th at Baylog Auction, Lethbridge, Alberta. On offer approximately 50 top quality bulls and 12 red heifers. You can see them at ulrichherfords.com. These bulls are the sons of industry leaders. For more information, call Peter, 403-625-1036. Ulrich Herford, specializing in light birth weights with great performance plus remarkable cows. That's February 25th, 1 p.m. at Baylog Auction, Lethbridge, Alberta. That number again, 403-625-1036. Gotta say a big thanks to Peter Ulrich and the family supporting this program since about now 2012, and that is gonna be a great sale. Now, just ahead of the Rangeland news, I have another fine song about wild horses, this time from Tom Cole, and on the Rangeland news, I'll break the story of an event that will involve Tom Cole and our Western Spirit Band.
Heading out to Montney Creek, there's wild ones running there. Never failed to rope a brand, human hand ain't touched their hair. Pack your duffel and your saddlebags, your fall coat and your rope. We'll trail down to Montney Creek, we'll camp out on the slope. The wild ones graze out on the ridge, so we'll move in from the flats. Box them in the coulee and we'll pull our lariats. Rounding up the slick ones, put them in the rope corral. A buyer with a southern drawl is coming north in the fall. He says he's gonna take them all if they ain't broke the leading ride. know they'll never sell. Breaking horses at Montney Creek down by the wild horse track. Boy, you're down the rank ones, put your saddle on their backs. Tarp them out and brand them, pull the halter chains. Trim their hooves and cut their hair, that's money in the bank. Round enough to slick ones, put them in the rope corral. A buyer with the southern drawl is coming north in the fall. He says he's gonna take them all. They ain't broke the lead and ride, you know they'll never sell. A buyer with the southern drawl is coming north in the fall. He says he's gonna take them all. If they ain't broke the lead and ride, they'll never sell. Rounding up the slick ones.
How about a weekend pass to the 24th Annual Kamloops Cowboy Festival, March 19th to 22nd, 2020. Another outstanding lineup of the finest pure Western entertainers anywhere. Canadian legend Gary Veljar.
Searching for freedom, westward the wagons, they settled in the valleys of sagebrush and pine.
Tom Cole.
In a big prairie moon. Rides the big prairie sky.
The first Kamloops appearance for Doug Figgs.
A good horse under me, it's easy to see. I'm right here where I want to be.
A pasture full of great cowboy poets, the BC Cowboy Hall of Fame inductions, dinner shows, daytime entertainment, and a spectacular art and gear show workshop. The best place to get all the information, bcchs.com. To order tickets, call 1-888-763-2221.
Now the news of the Rangeland, a roundup of news and coming events from around the West.
At the top of page one, the headline says, more heifers in feedlots than there's been for a long time. And what does that mean? Well, Gary Crawford is a guy with the answers.
2% more cattle and calves in feedlots this January 1st compared to 2019. Placements in feedlots during December, 3% more than a year earlier. This from Friday's USDA report on cattle feedlot activity. USDA livestock analyst Shail Shagham says there are two more telling numbers in there. First, there are 4% more heifers and heifer calves in feedlots than a year ago, and those heifers comprise a little bit more of the total inventory than 1 year ago. But he says whether this means a halt to expansion or a contraction or what, it's hard to know.
There are a lot of moving parts.
There could be several factors here. Cow-calf operators have been seeing relatively poor returns.
Compound to that the fact that you were tight forage supplies in much of the country. Now some of the forage conditions have improved, although the quality is very spotty. So that may be a non-price factor that's influencing producers. Is again, at this time of year, you're thinking, do I have enough forage to overwinter my animals?
To get them to the spring breeding season, we'll learn more about intentions today with USDA's Big Cattle Inventory Report. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Washington.
If you are looking for a ranch to buy, the Brewster Ranch in far west Texas just came on the market, and it's about 420,000 acres. Kentucky businessman Brad Kelly has it for sale, and according to Forbes magazine, Kelly's the seventh largest landowner in the U.S., and the Brewster Ranch is the biggest ranch to be listed since the 520,000-acre W.T. Wagoner Ranch sold in 2016 for about $725 million. And speaking of people selling ranches, Hall of Fame quarterback and Fox NFL Sunday analyst Terry Bradshaw has listed his 744-acre Love County, Oklahoma cattle and quarter horse ranch for sale. It's located just across the Red Deer River from Texas near Dallas, and it has working equestrian and cattle facilities and a big house and a pool and much more. The current listing doesn't include a price, but Terry Bradshaw previously listed the property in 2016 for $10.8 million, and he says he just doesn't have enough time to enjoy the ranch anymore. At his age, he's too busy. Well, a few years ago, I narrated an audio book about a hearing service dog. His name was Crackers, and the title was Crackers Come Here. It contained a lot of adventures that Crackers and his owner Denny had with getting on public transportation with a service dog, particularly flights. Well, the U.S. Transport Department has just proposed giving airlines the power to bar emotional support animals from cabins and limit the definition of a service animal to a trained dog. That means no more goats, turkeys, or pigs, and they are also looking at miniature horses. Airlines have been complaining that passengers have been able to exploit the designation by bringing their pets and other exotic creatures on board, and quite often they are not legitimate service animals. By the way, that audiobook is still for sale, and you can find it on the merchandise page at our website, hugh-mcclennan.com. Next regular cattle sale at the BC Livestock Co-op Yards in Kamloops is February 25th. And there's a regular sale at the Williams Lake Yards on February 26th, and a regular sale at the Vanderhoof Yards on the 28th. Get the details and see the sales streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, regular cattle sales every Wednesday. The next horse sale is February 22nd. Lots of special sales coming up, and you can see them at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. Now, just ahead of the famous final item, here's some news that you fine folks up in the Peace Country could look at: the Western Spirit Band. With my super pickin' little brother Jim and our super bass player Uncle Mike Daggert, will bring our show of amazing music of the West, songs and stories and lots of laughs, to Fort St. John for Concert 83 at the Lido in Fort St. John, May 23rd, 22nd and 23rd. And we'll be joining the great Tom Cole and some terrific performers. You can get tickets online at thelido.ca or call them at tickets. Call them at 250-785-3011, or you can go to the Lido in person at on 100th Avenue in Fort St. John. Okay, now the final item. Billy and I were trying to book a hotel room in a town where our grandsons were playing hockey. And she was calling a bunch of them, and I offered to help. "Are you sure you want to do this?" she said. And I said, "Well, sure, watch this." I called a number that she gave me, and a nice female voice said, "Good morning, Best Western." And I said, "Oh, Monty Walsh with Tom Selleck." And that's the Rangeland News. Coming up on the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, an examination of the term natural horsemanship, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. How about a weekend pass to the 24th annual Kamloops Cowboy Festival, March 19th to 22nd, 2020. Another outstanding lineup of the finest pure Western entertainers anywhere. Canadian legend Gary Velgar.
Searching for freedom, westward the wagons, they settled in the valleys of sagebrush and pine.
Tom Cole.
And a big prairie moon rides the big prairie sky.
The first Kamloops appearance for Doug Figgs.
A good horse under me, it's easy to see. I'm right here where I want to be.
Pasture full of great cowboy poets, the BC Cowboy Hall of Fame inductions, dinner shows, daytime entertainment, and a spectacular art and gear show workshop. The best place to get all the information, bcchs.com. To order tickets, call 1-888-763-2221. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Coming up on the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, a look at what the term natural horsemanship may mean. And more from Barry Davis, executive producer of the Wild Ones TV series. But first, Billy and I have spent some time reflecting on the wonderful times we've had after hosting over 1,200 people who love the Western way of life on 19 Spirit of the West cruises. After 120-some flights, over 90 hotel room visits, and through our challenges, including Billy's with radiation treatments and my journey with end-stage kidney disease, doing dialysis from Mexico to Alaska, that it's probably time for us to take a step back from cruise hosting after the next one. Ah, we have so many vivid memories and video of our members of our group ziplining in Mexico, having many memorable trail rides from Prince Edward Island to Mazatlan, walking down Broadway in New York City with the locals all wanting pictures of our cowboy hats, touring and visiting ranchers and farmers from Jamaica to Ireland, seeing the hidden treasures of Australia and New Zealand, the wonders of the Panama Canal, and so much more. And our unforgettable sing-along sessions with the Spirit of the West Choir. And we sure want to thank each and every one of you who joined us over the last 20 years. By booking with the Spirit of the West, you've helped us keep this program going all these years. Our farewell cruise called The Spirit of the West Brings It Home is coming up. We wanted to eliminate some of the hassles of long-distance travel and make it an unforgettable experience, so we'll gather you all up here at our ranch on July the 15th for a lunch and a concert with the Western Spirit Band and a special guest. From there, we go to the fabulous Sun Peaks Resort for a barbecue and sightseeing. The next morning, we all go down to the coast and we'll board the Holland America beautiful ship Koningsdam for a 7-day cruise up the Inside Passage and back. No flying required. This package includes the amazing White Pass Rail Tour and so much more. Now, this one is filling pretty fast, so if you'd like to join us, just call the number 1-800-530-0131 to reserve your spot. Deposits are refundable up until April the 3rd.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Okay, you know that Irvine's is all about Western wear with a welcome twist. But Irvine Tack and Western Wear is also famous for their home decor with a Western twist. Beautiful, rustic dining room and kitchen tables, wooden chests and drawers, bedroom furniture, wall decor, and more. So stop in soon, take your time, and explore Irvine's Western home decor. Something special for every room and every nook and cranny. Exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield.
Canada's largest Western store.
And, of course, you can shop online. Check them out at urbansaddles.ca.
If you Google natural horsemanship, you'll probably get 428,000 pages in about 19 seconds. For a lot of us, it starts with watching a round pen demonstration where a trainer gets a horse to face up and hook on without using a halter or rope. And the first time you see it, it's impressive. Then it develops to the point where the trainer gets the colt to look at him with both eyes and turn and face him, then follow him around the pen. Next, he gets the colt sacked out and saddled without using a halter or any restraint, and then the horse bucks like crazy with a saddle. Sometimes. Our main event trainer's challenge has raised some concerns with some members of the public because we are challenging a trainer to take an unbroke colt to the point where he can ride him through an obstacle course in a big arena after only 3 hours of round pen work. Can that be done without using any restraints of any kind? Well, not very often. I think the revolution in horsemanship has, by and large, made the world better for horses by the people who are savvy enough to know how to read horses accurately. I've had a lot of horses that I could ride at a controlled lope without a bridle, and I've had a lot of good horses that I needed to have a lot more control on for a long time. I think that if natural horsemanship means having a horse try his absolute best to figure out what you're asking him and do it as well as he can because he respects you as his leader and he trusts you, then I'm all for it. And that's the Horse Training File.
For Irvine Saddles and Western Wear, and something that our horses do really well on is a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out all about it at hoffmanshorseration.com. How about a weekend pass to the 24th annual Kamloops Cowboy Festival, March 19th to 22nd, 2020. Another outstanding lineup of the finest pure Western entertainers anywhere. Canadian legend Gary Velgar.
Searching for freedom.
westward the wagons, they settled in the valleys of sagebrush and pine.
Tom Cole.
In a big prairie moon rides a big prairie sky.
The first Kamloops appearance for Doug Figgs.
A good horse under me, it's easy to see. I'm right here where I want to be.
Pasture full of great cowboy poets, the BC Cowboy Hall of Fame inductions, dinner shows, daytime entertainment, and a spectacular art and gear show workshop. The best place to get all the information, bcchs.com. To order tickets, call 1-888-763-2221. Barry Davis is executive producer of the Wild Ones TV series, and he's still on the line, and the filming of a reality series like this one is different than a scripted dramatic series with full rehearsals, because obviously once the cameras start rolling, you really can't predict what's going to happen.
Oh, that was a hard lesson to learn for about 2 weeks. Yeah, like so many times we just didn't. It's a very big deal to those cameras that we're filming with are quite heavy. They're cumbersome. You need an ATV to move them around, and the terrain is ridiculous. There's no roads, there's no way to get to where you can get to on horseback, so we really relied on the riders to be able to tell us where the horses are going to go and where can we get to in a position where they're not going to see us. We're in a wildlife blind, so the horses won't see us and then turn around and go the other way. So we had to sort of figure that out. And then if you've watched the series, you understand that there's a lot of camera work that's done by the chasers themselves. The cameras are embedded with the chasers while they're in the midst of what they're doing. So a lot of the discussions between the chasers and the radio chatter and when they're in full flight, those are cameras that those guys are wearing themselves, because we're nowhere near them. We can't go to where they go at the speeds that they go, but it turned out to be a really captivating way of showing how this goes about.
Well, I would think the average viewer has, you know, they're captivated by the final production that they're watching, but they have no idea what went into it to get that. Like, even how was the audio picked up? You know, how did you get the conversation between these two guys when they're on the dead run like that?
Exactly. It was funny. That was like, it was a very, very difficult thing. One of our sort of lead sound man, David, he had devised systems that they could wear to record their audio that would run all day long. And sometimes when they're wearing those, body cams, sometimes the batteries on the body cam would die before the batteries in their audio recording device. So we have to find a way to be able to replace the batteries in the cameras, then marry that back up with the sound that they're wearing. And it's very important for us to get a picture of how the chases go down. We would listen and monitor on the walkies and kind of try and figure out where they went and what happened. But then when you get back, you realize all of these dramas took place out in the field, and you know, they saw them over here, but then they chased them this way, and then Emery Phillips saw them, and then he chased them back over this way, and they figured out a system to be able to bring the horses to where they need them to go. But it's only through all of that technology and the cameras that they're wearing and the audio devices they're wearing that picture gets told.
Oh, wow. Well, Barry, I'd like to continue with this next week, because there's more stories about the cast and crew that I'm sure folks would like to hear. And speaking again of wild horses, here's a great song that Bob Wagner wrote a while back.
Mustang, wild Mustang, he's desert bred, he's underfed and tough as a pinion tree. No cowboy pals or poker owls, just wild and running free. No thing of beauty most would say, but beauty's hidden there. It's in the blood of rangy stud and heart of a Mustang mare. A rocky rim is home to him, or he roams the endless sand, where the coyotes wail and the desert trail his lonely wandering band. Stories told by cowboys bold and songs of him they sang, tell plaintively how great must be the heart of the wild Mustang. Mustang, wild Mustang. Mustang, wild Mustang,
hillside some starry night across the sandy dune, or standing high against the sky beneath the desert moon. His coat is rough and nature tough, but his disposition's mild. The Mustang Steve was born to heed the call of the western wild. His color might be kinda red, buckskin white or dun, gruey gray, black or bear, the color of the sun. Stories told by cowboys bold and songs of him they sang tell plainly how great must be the heart of the wild Mustang.
Bob Wagner, of course, singing all the parts and playing all the instruments and coming up a piece of cowboy poetry about an amazing wild stallion, and then our classic Song of the West, When the Spirit of the West, continues right after this. How about a weekend pass to the 24th annual Kamloops Cowboy Festival, March 19th to 22nd, 2020. Another outstanding lineup of the finest pure Western entertainers anywhere. Canadian legend Gary Velger.
Searching for freedom, westward the wagons, they settled in the valleys of sagebrush and pine.
Tom Cole.
In a big prairie moon. Rides the big prairie sky.
The first Kamloops appearance for Doug Figgs.
A good horse under me, it's easy to see. I'm right here where I want to be.
A pasture full of great cowboy poets, the BC Cowboy Hall of Fame inductions, dinner shows, daytime entertainment, and a spectacular art and gear show workshop. The best place to get all the information, bcchs.com. To order tickets, call 1-888-763-2221. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. For this week's classic Song of the West, we go way back to the pen of Curly Fletcher, who wrote the famous Strawberry Roan, and also a song called The Ridge Running Roan, done here by Randy Haller.
I was out on the Badlands wrangling alone when I heard of a cayuse, a ridge running roan. He was fleet as a deer and as tough as a mule, pretty as a picture and nobody's fool. I go right to work and I gets me a pair of the best saddle horses that ever wore hair. I hunts up that Mustang, I camped on his trail. When he takes to the ridges, he packin's the mail. He stays on the ridges as wise as a fox. He's like an old goat when he gets in the rocks. I trails him till dark and at dawn I begin. Oh, I'm getting weary, my horses get thin. I stay by his track till I get stiff and sore. He stay way out front, but he makes 20 more. No time to water and no time to graze. I camped on his trail for 17 days. I starts into Carrotton and turns him around. He quits the high ridges and he goes to low ground. I build me a loop when I gets to the flat, and I throws my old lasso, she fits like a hat. I takes him to camp and into the corral, and I feeds him some oats and some hay for a spell. He gets fat and strong and I give him the news. I hog-tied him down and I tacked on some shoes. I throws on my saddle, I screws her down tight, then I crawls to his middle and he goes on the fight. He's mad as a hornet and sure seeing red, when I goes to some fish and then I plumb lost my head. I'm doing my best and I'm just getting by. He's doing much better than a blotting his eye. I think I'm on top of a hurricane deck, where an earthquake and a cyclone is having a wreck. Then he hits with a jar that sure gave me a scare. I'm away up above him, but I don't know just where. And riding rat horses, I'm no cripple squaw. He showed me some tricks that I ain't never saw. Of all the old fuzztails that I've ever rode, there's nothing here like him, he seemed to explode. A gyrating jump, he just leaves the corral, and it makes a big hole in the ground where I fell. Now the last time I saw him, he's crossing the bridge. He's a high-tailing back to his favorite ridge. I'm hunting my saddle, I'm on my own. My riggin' run off with that ridge-running roan. I'm all busted up and I'm still sore and lame. That ridge-running roan will never be tame. Take my advice and just leave him alone. You won't have no luck with that ridge-running roan.
We've been on the subject of wild horses all day today, and you know, the first time I read this poem written by Darrell Arnold, I was really moved, and I'd like to share the story today of a horse called Devil's Pride. On the west side of the Rockies, where the Selkirk Mountains stand, roamed an old unbranded stallion and his freedom-loving band. Feral horses had been grazing there for nearly 100 years, descendants of the livestock that escaped the pioneers. Though they numbered only 20 then, they once in hundreds ran before the herds were gathered for the saddle and the can. But the old unbranded stallion, never captured and always free, was a source of song and legend and a taunting mystery. At times, he'd roam the ranges and he'd steal a rancher's mares, and they'd try and rope and trap him, but he always slipped their snares. At night, his spectral figure neath the moon's abundant light made the superstitious shiver at his image ghostly white. Now, in those mountains lived a rancher who was proud and bold and strong, and he swore this devil stallion had been running free for too long. So he gathered all his cowboys and he bade them all to ride and not return until they'd caught that horse called Devil's Pride. Now the mountain trails were wild and steep, but the Mustangs knew the way, and the cowboys rode and tracked and searched, and they followed for so many days till one by one the mares and foals were roped and caught, but one remained out there, the stallion Devil's Pride, still free and on the run. The cowboys dogged his every move. They watched from rocky knolls, they rode the ridges, they combed the draws, and they even blocked the water holes. They tried to wear the stallion down, they never let him rest. But the rancher wanted Devil caught, so on and on they pressed. But Devil's Pride would not give in. He loved his freedom so. And the weary cowboys asked themselves, how much further could he go? One day they had him cornered, blocked in where the walls were high, but the stallion bared his teeth and charged, and the cowboys had to let him by. Ah, caballo mucho, someone said, and the others nodded true. This horse they were chasing was special, and for him their fondness grew. Still on and on they rode. To catch him was their aim, and the man that roped old Devil's Pride would wear a hero's name. And then one day, at a place called Eagle Point, the cowboys found their prey. They had him trapped at last, and it looked like this was going to be the day. The stallion turned again to run, but there was no place left to go, and the rimrock cliffs in front of him dropped 1,000 feet below. So he turned again to the attack, and he charged the cowboy line. And that's when he felt at once the roper's twisted twine. The roper yelled he'd caught the stud. This was the victor's prize. But a moment later, stark terror filled his eyes. For Devil's Pride, the great white horse, could not his freedom give. Within him burned a spirit that could not, as a captive, live. The stallion reared and pawed and kicked and tossed his head goodbye, and he ran and jumped from Eagle Point to fly and fall and die. The roper screamed and dropped his dallies, and the sizzling rope came free, and how close to death that cowboy came was plain for all to see. And on the rock so far below lay the form of Devil's Pride. The saddened cowboys doffed their hats, whispered prayers, and cried. And then turned to head for home, because their mighty quest was done. No more would mares be stolen from this stallion on the run. And yet somehow, it was clear the horse had won,
because it was plain for all to see that Devil's Pride would always remain unbranded, wild, and free. As always, thanks so much for riding along, and I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time. Special thanks to our support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. Remember, if you need tractor parts, see Mark's page, bctractorparts.com. Hope you can check out our YouTube and podcast versions of this program. Details at our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.